thanks for coming. I'm going to talk today about some work I've been doing at the University of Turku in Finland, mainly with Hannu Mäkinen and Craig Kramer, but also there's many other people that have contributed to this research. My study is on local adaptation in Atlantic salmon. And before I start, I just want to convince you that salmonid fishes, salmon and trout and other species, are really good models for examining the genomic basis of adaptation to different environmental conditions. Salmonid fishes are strongly phylopatric. For example, there's many anadromous species which feed in the ocean but return to their natal stream to spawn. And almost every population genetic study of salmonid fishes has shown that there's very fine scale population structure within species and within rivers and other water bodies. Salmonids inhabit a large diversity of habitats, which differ in size, in water flow, in temperature, multiple environmental conditions. And within a single water body, it's frequently found that salmonids diversify into ecotypes which are partially reproductively isolated. Examples are Arctic char, which occur in populations which specialize on different prey types and morphologically differentiated. Whitefish, which occur in dwarf and normal forms, and many other examples. One other great thing about working on salmonids is that there's several commercially important species, and this means we've got great genomic resources that we can utilize. For example, for the species that I work on, Atlantic salmon, there's a complete annotated genome that has been published in the last 2 years. There's several related species, including rainbow trout, for which the genomes are pretty well put together. With Atlantic salmon and with several other species, there are SNP chips available. We currently use a chip which has 220,000 SNPs. You can get chips that go up to 900,000 SNPs. So that makes the process of assaying variation across the genome much easier. And there's been a lot of work to identify genes in QTL underlying commercially important traits. Genes we find when looking for local adaptation, we can quite often label them with functional roles. And there's various, salmon are charismatic, people like them, so there's a lot of interest in using genomic approaches to guide conservation and management. So we really, really benefit from a lot of advantages when we use these species. Our study site is a extremely large Atlantic salmon population in the Tenno River of northern Finland in Norway. This is a large Arctic river system. It includes many tributaries, and work to date has shown that these tributaries contain Atlantic salmon populations which are pretty strongly genetically differentiated from each other. And that signature of genetic differentiation is stable over time. There's a big diversity in habitats, ranging from very small tributaries to very large main stem rivers. And there's also a big diversity in life history in these salmon. But the trait that's most carefully been looked at is the time the salmon spend in the ocean before they come back to their natal river. And it's recently been shown that the variation in this time is overlaid by a single gene of large effect. But apart from this trait, there actually hasn't been that many ecological studies looking at morphology of the different populations or behavior of the different populations in the different tributaries. So we were interested in taking a genomic approach to populations in these different tributaries And see if we can identify teams that would be involved in local adaptation between the different populations. So we collected up to 25 juvenile fish from each of these 12 locations, and we genotyped them all with the SNP chip for 220,000 SNPs. This is a multi-dimensional scaling plot based on genome-wide identity by state, just to demonstrate that there is indeed pretty strong population structure within this sample. Here we have all the populations in the main stem and the headwaters, and then these very differentiated populations are all in small tributaries. But then if we just look at this cluster, you can see within this main stem and headwater cluster, there's also strong population differentiation. These populations do differ in their environmental conditions. We took a very broad scale approach and just looked at several wide scale environmental variables. And we decompose those into two principal components. So effectively, most of the environmental variation was explained by one principal component, which pretty much equates to how far the salmon have to swim from the ocean to get to their spawning site. And the second principal component pretty much equates to how much water is flowing through that spawning site, so how big the river is. We used several methods to identify regions of the genome under selection. Because different FSD outlier tests have different type 1 and type 2 errors, and because we wanted to really narrow down our results to regions for which we had really good evidence that they were involved in local adaptation, we used multiple genome scans for outliers, and then we took a consensus approach, identifying the SNPs that were most strongly supported as being outliers from our different approaches. To look at associations between SNPs and environmental variables, we used two approaches, LFMM and BAYM, and again we took the consensus from those two approaches. And then once we've identified our SNPs that were most strongly identified as outliers or associated with the environmental variables, we looked for evidence of selective sweeps around those loci using their cross-population extended haplotype homozygosity test. And by the end of that winnowing down process, we identified 21 regions of the genome that had very strong evidence as being involved in local adaptation throughout the tenor. So this is a diagrammatic representation of where these regions actually are. Each point is a SNP distributed by its position on the chromosome, and you see that the blue SNPs are strongly associated with our first principal component, which equates to river distance from the ocean. The green SNPs associated with our second principal component, which associates with flow volume. And the other outlier SNPs that weren't associated with an environmental variable are shown in purple. I'm not going to talk about the annotation of all these SNPs, all these regions of the genome, because we're still working on it. But there's some that pop out really nicely as obviously having functional roles. The first, this strongly selected region on chromosome 12 is the major histocompatibility complex 2 DAB allele. It indicates that there's been strong directional selection by pathogens in some of these populations. normally MHC2 is expected to be under balancing selection, but these sort of selective sweeps on this locus have been found in other salmonid species. We found several genes that are known to be involved in feeding behavior or metabolism. Two interesting candidates on chromosome 10 are these two here. Neuronal growth regulator 1 in particular is a candidate obesity gene in humans, and it's likely to be associated with different metabolic rates or different feeding behaviors in different populations. This outlier on chromosome 17, we didn't actually find any coding genes in that region, but it's immediately upstream from one of the Atlantic salmon copies of the aryl hydrocarbon receptor 2. Atlantic salmon have, and salmonids in general, have 4 copies of this, and what's particularly interesting is that variation in expression of this gene is associated with differential development of cranial facial morphology, which is associated with trophic polymorphism in another salmonid species, Arctic char. So it's intriguing that this gene could also be involved in local adaptation of Atlantic salmon. Our strongest outlier is this region of chromosome 9, which comes up as extremely significant in all outlier tests we do. It's associated with a second principal component, that is river flow volume. This region of the genome has actually come up in several other studies. It was previously identified in a previous study of adult Tango salmon. It's also known to be an outlier associated with river flow amongst Norwegian salmon populations. And it contains several genes. The one we've been most focusing on is this transcription factor 6-6, which is important for the development of visual and auditory systems. And this is just showing you how variable this region is in our different populations. Some populations are almost 100% one allele, and some populations are almost But I'm just going to take us over to this, the Pacific coast, and talk about recent work that Veal and Rosello have done on sockeye salmon, where they've looked at regions of the genome that differentiate these two ecotypes, one of which spawns in the stream and one of which spawns in the lake. And they've just shown that a single genomic region is associated with this polymorphism, and this is centered on the gene LRRC9. And if we look at this gene on the Atlantic salmon genome, it's directly on our chromosome 9 outlier. So this suggests that this region of the genome is having the same role in differentiation in the two quite different species. So in summary, we see strong signatures of the vertical selections, and some of these genes seem to be involved not just in Atlantic salmon, but in other genera.